as always, are very thankful for our live stream brethren also. Amen. We're continuing in the Gospel of John tonight. This will be our 46th exposition of this book. We'll be in verse chapter 4, verses 19 through 22. We're going to be talking about the worship of God some tonight. And when it comes to the worship of God, men don't have the option of being wrong about it. Today there's an idea afoot in the Christian world that worship has a sanctifying influence. Some people speak of it as opening a portal into heaven, so that worship initiates a spiritual process. This is not true. Amen. Doesn't make any difference who teaches it. It's not true.
Right.
Worship is the result of knowing, believing, and loving the Lord.
Yes.
Worship doesn't cause an effect in you. Worship itself is an effect.
Yes, amen.
Yeah.
That's right.
Now, this is important to know, because this, since spiritual children have taken over the church, I hate to say that, but that's exactly what happened. We've got spiritual babies running and governing the church. They're not all young in age. Some are a little older, but they're still children. All manner of erroneous concepts have been developed. And error is a robber.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
And the more errors there are, the more people are robbed. And the church has been pillaged by erroneous theology.
Yes.
Some people teach every man can worship God in his own way. That's another view. We each worship God in our own way and so forth. But our text will show us that's not so, because the Samaritans had their own way.
Uh-huh, yes.
And God rejected it.
Uh-huh.
Now, this, you remember Jesus is talking to a woman at the well of Samaria. All really we know about her was she had five husbands and she was living with someone that wasn't her husband. That's pretty much the extent of what we know about her. But Jesus knew everything about her.
Yeah.
And he said enough. He knew all about her. And so she diverts the attention away from herself. And she's going to ask Jesus a question, and he'll answer her with great candor. This shows there's still a need for understanding in this area of worship. Of course, the Holy Spirit saw fit to record this in the scriptures for us. You might remember that Satan one time offered to give Jesus all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them if Jesus would worship Satan. And Jesus said, "It is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve." That's found in Luke 4:8. And it's a quotation of Deuteronomy 6:13 and Deuteronomy 10:20, where the word worship is not mentioned. Fear is the word that's used. Thou shalt fear the Lord God, and him only shalt thou serve. It puts a little different slant on slant on worship. But that's the text he quoted.
Yeah.
And fear. The truth of the matter is, people should be afraid not to worship God.
Yeah.
Amen.
To strike fear in their heart.
Yeah.
Of course, it doesn't, as you know. Now, our Lord's answer is going to shed light on the role of the Jews in all of this. And he's going to show the real divine view of Samaritan worship. And I think you'll find that today's worship is more like the Samaritan's worship. If you've got eyes to see, you'll see this. That the worship that is being promoted today in Christendom is more like Samaritan worship than it is real worship. So our text is John 4, 19 through 22. The woman saith unto him, Sir, I perceive thou art a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place to worship. Jesus saith unto her, Woman, believe me. The hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet in Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship, ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. All right, now, a lot of Christian people would consider that an arrogant answer. This answer would not be acceptable in the average church. This would not be an acceptable answer. They'd say this is arrogant, you ought to be gentle, would not be received. You just have to have some experience in the religious world to know this. Now, you notice how quickly Jesus said, she said, I'm not married. I don't have a husband. He said, you're right about that, you don't have a husband. You've had five husbands, and the man you're living with isn't your husband. And immediately she changes the subject. Gets off that right away. I don't think it was, I think it was fear that did it. That caused her to do this. By saying this, she's admitted that Jesus had hit the nail right on the head. But she didn't know anything about the mercy of Jesus or the love or grace. She didn't know anything about, she didn't know who this was. She didn't realize that he wasn't looking for a reason to condemn her. He just identified her condition, and he came into the world to resolve these kind of conditions. Now, she makes no effort to defend herself. Well, you don't realize what I've been through. You know, she makes no effort. She just moves on to something else. Now, the Samaritans received the writings of Moses, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. And the prophecy in Moses' writings, there were two prophecies about the Messiah, and he was going to be a prophet, be like unto Moses. This is a prophet that, like unto Moses, means that he had direct communication with God. And God told Moses that Aaron was his prophet, Moses' prophet. He says, Aaron will be your prophet. How's that? Huh? Yeah. Have a man had a personal prophet. How's that? Yeah. That's what he said. I think he was emphasizing his spokesman, but that's what he said. Yeah. Moses described prophets in general, prophets, as those upon whom God would put his spirit. See, he defined what the prophet was. The idea was a prophet had a direct communication with God on what to say. The prophet didn't like study the thing out and arrive at a conclusion. He was given a word from God. That's what a prophet did. Moses refers to prophets 12 times in all of his writings. They include the coming of the Messiah, legitimate prophets, and false prophets, but there wasn't a lot of mention about prophets. It wasn't frequent. He affirmed that God, he said to the people, would God that all the Lord's people were prophets. Mm-hmm. I don't think you'd ever hear a preacher say that. Yeah, yeah. But Moses said that.
That's right.
He was not a competitor, see?
Yeah, that's right.
Moses wasn't a glory seeker. He wasn't trying to get his name in the lights. It would have greatly pleased him if all God's people were prophets. So here the woman associates Jesus with being a prophet, not so much a prophet declaring the future, as a prophet that knows the circumstances of an individual. See, that was her concept of a prophet at this time. Shall I say the dominant consideration at this time? She saw him, I imagine, as a prophet like Elisha was. Elisha knew what the king of Syria was talking about in his bedchamber. Boy, what if we had prophets like that today? Got up and said, well, before Obama, President Obama went to bed last night, here's what he was thinking and planning. That's the kind of prophet Elisha was. That's what happened in his day. That's exactly what happened in his day. Yep, so I upset the king. He couldn't even make a secret plan without it being broadcast. You know, Paul talked about prophesying, exposing what people were thinking and what was in their minds. He posed a scenario there in 1 Corinthians 14 of a stranger or an unbeliever coming into their assembly. And all of the people were prophesying. Mm-hmm. Prophesying meaning, as 1 Corinthians 14 says, speaking of the edification, exhortation, and comfort. They're all prophesying. And unbeknownst to the people prophesying, what they're saying exposes this stranger. Mm-hmm. And he falls on his face and worships God and says, God's in you of a truth. See, that's why when you always want to speak when you have something to say and there's an opportunity to say it. You always want to speak up. God may use what you're saying. Who knows how he'll use it. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm sure that prophets with this could expose what was in a person's mind and heart. Peter exposed what was in Ananias' heart. Why has Satan filled your heart to lie to the Holy Spirit? See? Another, he said to another, you're in the gall of bitterness. They could, prophets, by the power of God, could open up things about an individual. She said, our fathers worshipped in this mountain. This mountain's the Mount Gerizim. That's the mountain from which all the blessings of the law were read. Now, some have said, well, she was referring to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I don't believe that. I don't accept that. I mean, I don't care who said it. I don't accept it. They say they worshipped in various places of this mountain. You know, well, I don't accept that. That's not the fathers she's talking about, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They built altars several places. In the plain of Moriah and Bethel, the plain of Mamre, Mount Moriah, Beersheba. See, they didn't have a this mountain. So it can't be them. You'd be surprised the theologians that say this, but it can't be them. Until the Jews settled in the land, there was no specific place to worship. After Israel was expelled from the land because of their idolatry, God kicked them out of the land of Canaan. He did it by the Assyrians who came in and took them away captive and left just a few people there to tend the vineyards and so forth. And then the king of Syria imported what had happened. There weren't many people in the land and they weren't God's people, so God sent lions. God sent lions into the land. Now, these people are pretty discerning people. They said, what's happened here is we're not worshiping the God of the land. They knew that this land had a particular God. This land belonged to somebody, some God. And so the king said, I want you to find a priest that was taken out of the country, captive, and send him back into the country to teach people the manner of God, so they don't be agitating God by the way they live. Now, this is just me talking right here. But it might be that in the United States of America, we might be having a situation like that. That the God is so unknown that even religious people are doing things that's agitating God. And instead of calling for somebody that knows God, searching out and finding out someone like this, you see, they've completely ignored the situation. At any rate, when they brought this priest in, he taught the people. But the people, they didn't do what he said. Here's what it, what they did. They feared God and served their own gods. This is found in 2 Kings 17:33. And served their own gods after the manner of the nations whom they carried away from thence. That is to say, these people that were imported from various nations, they brought their gods with them, so to speak, and they structured their religion after they'd been taught by this priest. Yeah. They structured their religion after their own gods. And then the text adds, unto this day they do after the former manners, they fear not God, neither do they after their statutes and after their ordinances or after the law and commandment of the Lord, commanded the children of Israel, whom he named his children of Jacob, whom he named Israel. So the, that's the fathers that the woman's talking about. That's the fathers. The other ones that established the kind of worship that was going on, it wasn't Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. We ought to note that all false religion has its fathers. The movement with which I was identified, they had fathers, they called them fathers. The Restoration Fathers, so they, that's what they call them. Every body of religion has its fathers, its originators. The Jews had Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that was their fathers. See? To us, Jesus has taken the place of fathers. See? And then he has dispensed the authority to his apostles and prophets. And that's an important thing to me to notice, that you might call it tradition. Every denomination has its tradition that was formed by men. And whoever's, whoever the person is that's in that kind of situation, and I myself was in it, it's very difficult to break out of that. Because it causes people to live independently from God. They're not living by faith in God, they're living by, I hope what we believe here is right. That's how they live. That's why they don't study the scriptures. That's why they don't know the scriptures. That's why their meetings are infrequent and very brief. That's why, see? Because they have enough sense to know they can't explain why they believe what they believe. They don't, it's not rooted in. Fathers. Now she says, you say, our fathers, they worshiped on this mountain. Yeah. Ye say that Jerusalem's a place to worship. Now she says, ye say, she means you Jews. She doesn't mean that Jesus himself. So this was an issue. See, this was an issue, and at last she found someone she could talk with, I guess, about this. And she said, now you Jews, you say they worship in Jerusalem, and that's not what we've been taught. Jesus himself said of Jerusalem, this is found in Matthew 5:25. He said, it's the city of the great king. That's what Jesus said. Solomon built the temple there in Jerusalem. The psalmist said that that is where the temple was built, Psalm 68:29. When the city of Jerusalem was destroyed, unlike other cities, it didn't remain in that state. It was rebuilt. See, because God put his name there. When the temple was destroyed, it was twice rebuilt. Because until Jesus came, that was a center. That was the center of where God was working. So he did not allow it to be destroyed. Her view, you say that, that Jerusalem's a place to worship. This is what God ordained, that Jerusalem was a place to worship. When it comes to the service of God, this is what the traditions of men do. They readjust how people worship and serve God. They change it from Jerusalem to Mount Gerizim. See, they change. It's what men do. Tradition always does this. See, for tradition, human tradition, human religious tradition, to be valid, you've got to somehow get rid of the truth of God.
Yeah.
Because God won't support this other system. Uh-huh. So you've got to get away, so they get away from the place where God's dominant. See, that's what they do. Traditions of men, they actually blind men. And when truth contradicts their customs, they default to the to the custom, and then they'll explain it by saying, we don't understand what the Lord meant. We will find that the answer from Jesus, he will not credit people with validly worshiping God who are wrong. This is not what men do now. Religious men will say, well, they're sincere. She was sincere. But her worship wasn't accepted. Because it was misdirected. And he'll let her know this. Now, this is Jesus talking, with whom the Christian world is rapidly becoming unacquainted. So how's Jesus going to answer that? Our fathers say, this word, this mountain, this is where we worship. You Jews say Jerusalem's where we worship. She didn't ask Jesus any questions. She just made this statement. So how is he going to answer this? He says, woman, believe me. Now, as with all of Christ's words, his words are with our spirit and they are life. That's John 6:63. The words I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. These are living words. So these words he spoke, believe me. His words are life.
Amen.
Think of believe me as having all of the power of stretch forth your hand.
That's right. Yes.
Amen.
Think of believe me as having all the power of arise, take up your bed and walk.
Uh-huh.
See, the word he speaks.
That's right.
Is accompanied with divine power.
Amen.
Believe me. Yeah. Oh boy, this is something to see.
Yeah.
Let's take another word that Jesus said. Fear not. See? You know, power comes to for you to actually do that.
That's right. Amen.
We require for you to believe. Here's another one. Be not faithless, but believing. Yeah. See?
Yeah.
That word is accompanied with power. You can view what Jesus says as like a law, like Moses, or as something that can be done because he said it.
Amen.
His word is with power. See, his word's with power. So what he says, when you hear what he says and you realize in your heart he said it, you will be able to do what he said just as surely as a blind man saw. And a lame man took up his bed and walked, and a man with a withered hand stretched it out, see, and a leper was cleansed. You're just that surely. But there's a lot there. He says, believe me. Yes.
That's why when you hear something Jesus has said, you better believe it.
That's right.
I mean, if you hear it, that means the Lord's giving you ears to hear this thing. So if you deny it, then you're turning your face away from God.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, power is resident. Now, how it washes out, that you can resist.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
You can resist the power, but the power's there.
Yeah.
And in all of the examples of Jesus doing something with his word, from creation on down, and all what he said happened. He never spoke in vain. He never said, rise up and walk, and the person said, well, I just can't do it.
That's right.
That never happened.
Yeah.
But today there's a whole lot of people that say they've heard Jesus say something, but they haven't done it.
That's right.
Why haven't they done it? It's because they didn't believe.
Yes. Amen.
Yeah, that's right.
Now, when it was difficult, sometimes it's difficult to believe. It's not easy to believe. And so the man that had the possessed son, he said, Lord, I believe. Help thou my unbelief. See, that's what you say when you feel deficient. That's how you respond.
Yeah. A lot of
of the speakers nowadays are neutering what Jesus said. They'll say things like, well, Jesus said, take up your bed and walk, but you know how we are.
Yeah.
And they'll take away the power.
Yeah. Yeah, there are... Today, there are people that speak about faith. I think they oversimplify it. Mm-hmm. But they've seen something. That you can do it if you can see it, you can do it. See, they've seen something. And I understand that some people corrupt that, but there's something there. They've seen a little of the afterglory. I can see it. Some of them, they pretend. If it doesn't happen, they'll pretend. Mm-hmm. See, I've been healed, but I just got the symptoms, you know. Because June's mother said, well, I wouldn't mind having the disease if I didn't have the symptoms. It's them symptoms that give us the trouble.
That's right.
See? But they're on to something. God has left a witness. It may be a clumsy witness, but there's something there to be seen. And I'm the older I get, I'm less tolerant of these explanations that try and explain why people don't get well. I don't like these explanations. I'd rather someone say, let's fight the good fight of faith. Let's work on this thing of believing God.
Amen.
Believe me, the hour cometh. Oh, boy. Another version say, a time is coming. An hour is not like a solar hour. It's a point, a specific point in time. A God-ordained point in time. It's not something that may happen. It's something that's coming. It's going to happen. Point in time. A time that determined by God. And God alone can determine times and seasons. You know, the disciples said to Jesus after he had risen from the dead and he'd been with them. They said, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? Now they'd ask 20th century theologians, they'd say, come on, folks. That's not going to happen. But that's not what the king said.
Yeah,
he said, it's not for you to know the times or seasons which God has put in his own power.
Yeah.
That's on the agenda, all right, but God hasn't divulged further information. Times and seasons belong to God. God, no time during which God works comes that has not been appointed.
Yeah.
You got to really see that. The Savior entered the world when it was appointed.
Yes.
He died when it was appointed. He rose from the dead when it was appointed. He went back to heaven when it was appointed. He began reigning and sent forth the Spirit when it was appointed. See? Divine appointments. The hour cometh, that's speaking about a divine appointment. There's something on the horizon. It's just times. See that we're used to living with appointed times. Day.
Yeah.
Right? That's appointed time. Night. That's an appointed time. Seed time. Yeah, it's appointed time. Harvest. That's an appointed time. So we're used to nature. He teaches us in nature that these aren't just random cycles that happened.
That's right.
These are appointments. There are periods of time when God deals with men in certain ways. There was a time described as from Adam to Moses. Romans 5 talks about from Adam to Moses, there was no law.
Yeah,
And God dealt with men as though there was no law.
Yeah.
And then there was from Moses to Christ. All right, that's bounded by a law. That's a law.
Yeah,
God told men what to do, when to do it, how to do it, where to do it.
Mm-hmm.
It was a law. That was his manner during that time. That's how he dealt.
That's right.
So he dealt with men. And then from the exaltation of Christ to the end of the world, that's a time during which there's a certain way in which God reacts and works with men.
Mm-hmm.
Periods. Key periods of time that supersede all other periods. In God's economy, times and things get better as time proceeds. What God does never goes backwards.
Yeah. Amen.
See, sometimes men, they advance, but they decline morally. See, but that's not the way God is. Everything is better. It's from glory to glory. Yes. See, it's better. Amen. There's a time coming. It's gonna be a better time. This is the way God works. There are key periods of time that supersede all other periods of time. I'll name some of them for you here. There's the time of the end. It's not going to give way to any other time. The end. There's the coming of the Lord. That's a time. There's the resurrection of the dead. That's a time, point of time. There's a day of judgment. That's a point of time. And these times are all times during which no one will be able to make an adjustment of any kind. They're just the kind of time that if you're not, when the time comes, if you're not ready, you will not be able to get ready.
Amen.
So these times supersede.
Yes.
Everybody should be living in view of these times that are coming. Now they're coming. Key periods of time. But there are also other periods of time, spiritual epochs during history, that bring unspeakable advantages and benefits. The entrance of the world, Lord, into the world was one of those. Unto you this day is born in a Savior, which is Christ the Lord.
Yeah.
See, it was an epoch started at that period of time. The era of the new covenant. That was a new era, a new period of time. It entered when time when men would have access to God. His grace would be upon men. It would be a time of reconciliation, fellowship with Christ, receiving the Holy Spirit in copious measures. This was a time promised to Abraham under the word blessed. All families of the earth be blessed. See? This was a coming time. And Jesus is talking about that.
Yeah.
He's talking about the time of the new covenant.
Yeah, amen.
When God is going to deal with men upon the basis of what his son did instead of upon the basis of what they did.
Yeah.
If a person doesn't accept what Jesus did, then they'll be judged according to what they did.
Yeah.
That's the way it works. So he'll speak to this woman in view of that hour. Now Jesus will emphasize the better thing. He will not spend time talking about the covenant that was going to be obviated in three years. He won't spend time developing old covenant requirements. He could have, I suppose, but that's not what he did. He doesn't develop the current obligations for worship. He doesn't develop that. He just tells her about a time coming that if she commences to live in view of the time that's coming, it will answer all her questions about this. The kingdom of God was at hand. Now he says, neither in this mountain, nor this hour's coming, when neither in this mountain or in Jerusalem, you won't worship will not be confined to those areas.
Yeah.
The hour is coming. Up to this time, geographical and topographical places were specified.
Mm-hmm.
Canaan, Jerusalem, the temple, the synagogue. See, they were. But the time's coming when that's not going to be the case. Because as yet, the human spirit and the God had not been joined.
Yeah.
And until that happens, places become important.
Mm-hmm.
And where you are becomes important until your spirit is joined with God.
Uh-huh.
Then that changes the whole situation. You have access to God if you're bobbing up and down in the deep.
Uh-huh. That's right.
You can have access to God if you're in a lion's den or whatever. It all changes because the condition, the status of humanity was going to change. They were going to be joined to the Lord. which changes this question won't be asked by a person who knows they've been joined to the Lord. They'll not be asking, where do I worship? Believe me, this will not happen. Then he talks about worship the Father. Neither in this mountain or yet in Jerusalem, but will worship the Father. Some versions say do obeisance to the Father. What does it mean to worship the Father? When John the Apostle fell down before an angel two different times, the angel's response was, worship God.
Yes.
He was talking about what he did. He fell down. Worship God. Believe it or not, this is speaking about a physical posture. Paul said, I bow my knees to the Father. This is not a saying.
Right.
He did this. It was a visible recognition of the superiority of God. And we have quite a number of references in Scripture where people bowed their heads before the Lord. I listened, they bowed their heads. This is why we bow our head when we pray. It's an act of reverence. Not like a law, you better do this. That's not what I'm saying, but I'm saying this tells us more about you. If a person has respect for God, they'll bow before him. Physically.
Amen.
They'll do it. Incidentally, it's a matter of some to look about during prayer, you know. That's disrespecting God.
Yeah.
I don't care who it is. Care who it is. If it's you, it's you. You disrespect God.
Yeah.
Worship the Father.
That's right.
When you're aware of the Father, get yourself humbled down.
Yeah. Amen.
If it's a place where you don't have to do other things, bow or do something to where you're not distracted.
Yeah, that's right.
You're not distracted to other things. This is why we bow our heads, as I say. Those in Christ are said to worship God. Paul frequently spoke about how he bowed before the Father, humbled himself down. See, we live in a culture that teaches people not to respect people like this. People actually taught. We're all on an equal level. Well, we're not all on an equal level.
Yeah.
There's some people, when I'm before them, I don't feel like I'm their equal at all.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is the kind of society. God raised people like this. And they were before somebody that was actually superior. They were to respect them. He even told, there's a word to the church says, honor the king.
Yeah, amen.
Yeah. The king was Nero at the time. So those in Christ are said to worship God. We are they who worship God in the Spirit and rejoice in Christ Jesus. So it isn't that Christians should worship. They do worship. This is one of their traits. Like a living person breathes, right? One in Christ worships. It's just the way it is. The word worship in all of its varied forms occurs 6 times from Romans through Hebrews. Now, you know right away it was that someone from the 20th century didn't write those books. In Revelation, it's mentioned, I believe, 14 times. But it's always in response to what God did. There was worship. Worship is not driven by times and places, but by people who have a new heart, a new spirit, newness of life, and they're a new creation, and they know why they are. It's because of what God has done.
Yes, amen.
They worship God.
Yes.
So Jesus is telling her, time's coming when worship isn't going to be the issue.
Yeah.
Ye were, oh, now listen, this is Jesus talking now. Ye worship ye know not what. Well, how's that?
Yeah.
Let me give that to you from some of the other versions. You worship what you do not know, without knowledge of what you're worshiping. You people worship what you do not understand. You Samaritans know very little about the one you worship. Now we're talking about Samaritans. You'd think you're talking about church people, wouldn't you? This sounds just like you're talking to church people. What you have not known, you worship. You Samaritans know so little about him worshiping blindly. You worship one of whom you know nothing. You don't really know the one you worship. You worship something you know nothing about. You worship guessing in the dark. You Samaritans do not know what you are worshiping. You worship what you do not comprehend. Don't you see, brother, that this describes a lot of professing Christians?
Yeah.
Doesn't have to be this way.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
The gospel won't produce these kind of people.
Yeah.
So you don't even know what you're doing in your worship. Mm-hmm. That's his comment about the Samaritan worship. This is what he was saying.
Mm-hmm.
Was it polite? Well, he didn't destroy him, you know, so it was it was polite in that sense, but it was the truth.
Yeah.
If you're gonna rescue somebody, they have to know the truth.
Yeah.
Because you don't even know the one you worship. You're just going through something.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now we know this kind of thing still goes on.
Yeah.
Wherever there's unholy people, yes, this is why they're unholy. They don't know who they're worshiping.
Mm-hmm.
If they are worshiping, they don't know who he is. But he says we know what we worship. We being the Jews, we know what we worship. We worship that we know. We give worship to what we have knowledge of. We Jews know what we're worshiping. Well, see, the reason why they knew is because it was revealed to them.
Yeah.
Their religion was revealed. The Samaritan's religion was concocted.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
See, the Samaritan religion was developed by men. The Jews' religion was revealed by God.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
That's why they knew.
Amen.
Who they are worshiping.
Mm-hmm.
He's speaking of true Jews. I mean, I understand that. The Samaritan's religion was humanly devised.
Mm-hmm.
See, everything the Jews had was given to them.
Mm-hmm.
They had no teachers that discovered things. They only had prophets and to whom things are revealed.
Mm-hmm.
So God revealed himself to the fathers, and the fathers passed it along.
Amen.
Now, this is something else that is of deep concern. Abraham told Isaac, and Isaac told Jacob, and Jacob told Joseph, and Joseph told his brethren. They passed it out from generation to generation. But somewhere along the line, this stopped.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Jews taught their children when they were in Egyptian captivity. They taught their children, we're coming out of here. God's going to take us out of here. Do you know that there are a lot of Christian parents that have never told their children about the resurrection of the dead and the coming of Christ and the day of judgment? Some young children, you mention those things, they get a question look on the face, they won't have any idea what you're talking about. But the church has got to pass this on to their children from young up. When they learn to eat, start teaching them this.
Amen.
This happened 30, 40 years ago. There was one of the brethren there in Indiana. One of his daughters, she was about four. I think she's about four. Susanna Ebor. And she broke her arm, had her some way, had to wear a cast. And she was describing it to me one day. She said, Brother Given, she said, see my arm's here. But Daddy told me I'm going to get a new arm someday.
Amen.
Oh, I thought that's good.
Yeah.
That's how the Jews were taught. See, that's how they were raised up. Yes.
That's good to remind
people that are close to death as well.
Oh,
yes.
There's a
lady that I worked with, and she had an oxygen tank. She was sitting at the front desk at school, and I said, Joy, don't get used to this body, because you've got a new one coming.
That's right.
And she died that weekend, and I'm so glad that was our last conversation.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Don't hide these things. Amen. Tell them. That's what the Jews did. We know we were. See, that was a lot of generations that passed. When he said that, there had been a lot of generations passed, but they hadn't lost this.
Yeah.
The faithful Jews had not lost this. It ought to be noted here that God is selective about who knows him. All men have not been made privy to to these things. From the beginning, God chose who he's going to reveal himself to. He chose Noah. He told Noah, he didn't tell anybody else. Told Noah. He chose Abraham, told Abraham, Isaac and Jacob, and Joseph, Moses. See, he selected people he told. Divulged what he was going to do. He told the prophets. He told John the Baptist. He chose people. He divulged what he was going to do to certain people who were then charged with proclaiming that and announcing that. Zophar, in the book of Job, Zophar posed the question, canst thou by searching find out God? See, can you like discover who God is and what he does and what he thinks by, say, studying nature? You think it's going to come that way? No, it doesn't. You think you can strike on what God's eternal purpose is by disciplined study? That's something God has to make known, and that God did it. He did make known. That's the reason why the Jews knew who they were worshiping. It's because it was revealed to them. And at Mount Sinai, I mean, that was kind of a revelation that even when you read about it, gets your attention. The psalmist observed, thy way is in the sea, thy path in great waters, and thy footsteps are not known. So trying to see where God has gone, you got to be right close. Just like if you want to know where a boat's going, you got to be right at the tail end of that boat, because that weight's going to disappear. You won't be able to follow it. God's path is in the sea. It's just like that. If you're not close by, it closes up and you can't tell where he's been or where he's going. But he divulged it to them. Knowing who they worship was the result of revelation. Then he makes this statement. This is Jesus now. For salvation is of the Jews. That's some statement, isn't it? Do you hear people many times making that statement? You hear that being made, man? See, on the media or anything like that? I mean, I don't, but I don't hear everything. I don't hear that said very often. But this is the Son of God. Salvation is of the Jews, which means you better pay attention to the Jews that spoke for God.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
Hmm? Yeah.
All the books of the Bible written by Jews, you know.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. All the prophets were Jews. He divulged to them. Salvation is of the Jews. And they were a created race. They were a created race. And a divinely sustained race. This race was created from an impotent man and a barren woman. And the race was created from them. See, that's just so people know it's of the Lord.
Amen.
Not of works, lest any man should boast. See, just so people know this. This is how this nation came into being. And it was after some people tried to stamp them out. You couldn't make them slaves and cause them to die out. You couldn't command them to drown their male babies and cause them to die out. You couldn't take them into captivity and cause them to die out.
That's right.
See, this was God raised this people up.
Amen.
Chosen race. They're the vehicle through which salvation is made available to the world. Moses, who prepared us, he came from that race, see? John the Baptist prepared the way for Jesus, he came from that race. Lord Jesus, he was the premier person in that race. Lord Jesus Christ. The apostles, they came from that race. Yeah. This, so when he says salvation's of the Jews, he means they're the vehicle through which salvation came.
Yeah.
So Gandhi didn't bring salvation.
That's right.
Yeah.
Huh? Yeah. And all the authors of heathen religions, they didn't bring salvation. I don't think any of them claim to bring salvation, as a matter of fact. This is God's fulfilling his promise. The salvation is of the Jews. This is God fulfilling his promise to Abraham. All the families of the earth will be blessed through you. That's salvation of the Jews is a fulfillment of that promise. This means that God determined man would be rescued from a fallen state.
Yeah,
God
right.
determined this is going to happen.
Uh-huh.
He let sufficient time elapse so that everyone knew this was not going to happen automatically. It was not going to happen by human wisdom. Yeah. It was not going to happen by super teachers of some sort. He demonstrated through 4,000 years, four millennia.
Mm-hmm.
He confirmed this is, unless I do this, it is not going to be done.
Yeah.
And I'm going to do it through a people that will not be respected.
Uh-huh.
How about that? To this day, Hitler couldn't stamp them out.
Yeah.
Got rid of 6 million of them. He couldn't stamp them out. Salvation is of the Jews.
Yes.
God said to Abraham, I will bless them that bless you and curse them that curse you. That guarantees they would not be removed from the earth. See?
Uh-huh. Yes.
That means they're going to be here till the end.
Yeah.
And all families of the earth will be blessed. So it's going to begin with this smallest of all nations. It's going to begin with them. It's going to explode out and fill the whole earth. The divine attention was so singularly focused on the Jews that it is written to them pertains or belongs the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the service of God, the promises, whose are the fathers, and of whom concerning in the flesh Christ came, was over all God blessed forever. So all the key stuff belonged to them.
Mm-hmm.
Why? So that he would bring
salvation. Amen.
Through them. In other words, salvation can be brought in a scattergun approach.
Uh-huh.
He couldn't come that way. It had to be focused.
Uh-huh.
So he's narrowed it down. Salvation is of the Jews. When he says, whose are the fathers and of whom concerning the flesh Christ came, that passage in Romans 9 is a breakdown of the components of salvation.
Yeah.
Now this is the first of two times that Jesus is recorded to have used the word salvation. He only used it two times. This is one. The other is to Zacchaeus. He said, this day salvation has come to your house. Those are the only two times Jesus used this word. That shows how big the word is.
Yeah.
Salvation speaks of deliverance, transformation, conformity to the image of Christ, and eternal inheritance. See, that's what's in this package of salvation. It begins with transformation and regeneration. It concludes with inheriting all things.
Yeah.
He that overcometh shall inherit all things. It ends that way. And that whole process is salvation.
Yeah.
That's what it is.
Yeah.
And it's of the Jews.
Mm-hmm.
See, when you don't want to fall into the trap of thinking of salvation as initially being saved.
Yeah, that's right.
That's a beginning.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. And it's a work that has to be completed and performed till the day of Christ.
Amen.
Any of you have anything to say before we proceed, Brother Jason?
Yeah, anyone who comes to God, anyone who wants to know God, or anyone who wants to take the Bible seriously and wants to read the Scriptures, one of the first things that you have to see and you have to confess is that the real God is the God of the Jews.
That's right.
The real God is the God of Israel.
Right.
And it kind of sounds simple to say, but that's actually a pretty profound statement, because there are a lot of gods still today in the world.
Uh-huh. Yes.
And there's a lot of sloppy talk about God. And a lot of talk about God today has nothing to do with the real God.
Yeah. Mm.
They're false gods that people talk about. Sometimes even within Christendom.
Oh, I know. I understand.
They talk about gods that aren't. It's not the God of Israel they're talking about. It's some other. It's a false god. It's not necessarily a graven image like in the ancient world, but it's an intellectual idol.
Yeah.
It's
Amen.
An idea about God that isn't true. Therefore, it's a false god.
Mm-hmm. Most people to worship what they know not.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, the way your exposition of that phrase "salvation of the Jews" it led me to think that when salvation covers the earth, they're going to be the key people.
Yeah,
they're going to again be the vehicle through which this is going to take place.
Revelation speaks about that in a kind of a veiled way, but it refers to the whole house of Israel as virgins. They've never bought into any of these world religions as a people. They've never been absorbed by another religion.
Yeah.
That's interesting, huh? That's God protecting them. Mm-hmm. Yes?
Speaking about times, there's a point of time for this. You gave several examples of it. One that came to my mind, you might have mentioned it, but is the space to repent.
Yeah, that's right. Good.
There's many many examples in scriptures that time is given for space to repent, and you can see chances given so that you can change direction. That person that was in the example specifically to change direction, repent, and come to the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And if you take advantage of that space to repent, then You repent, you come to the Lord, and you've been given wisdom. So now that wisdom that you acquired during that space of repentance, you can understand more of the times better. You can prepare yourself for times.
Mm-hmm.
You can, there was one more I forgot about. The day of the Lord mainly, though, is what you can look forward to with more wisdom if you take advantage of that space to repent that you were given initially.
Amen.
Mm. Yeah, that's where he gave that false prophetess in Thyatira. He says, I gave her space to repent.
Yeah.
That's the one I thought of and couldn't remember exactly
said
what
she
it was.
Didn't, but the space was there. If there's a space to repent, repentance is possible.
Yeah.
That's one of the things that proves that God is just in all that he does.
Yes,
right. He will be just in condemning people because there was space for them to repent.
Amen.
And those who were glorified... Gathered into the wheat barns, it'll be just for him to do that as well because they took advantage of that space.
Amen.
Yeah, I appreciated you brought this out about woman, believe me. See, if you see it rightly, and this does have to be ministered, people do have to be told this, but you'll look at Jesus' words a lot different. Instead of just something that he said, it's like a promise. He's holding out something for you.
Yeah.
And all you have to do to get it is just believe it, just receive it, and the benefit of what he said will be yours.
That's right.
It's powerful.
Sister Barb?
Yeah. You mentioned that Jesus spent his time developing the better thing.
Yeah.
And in considering this, I was reminded, I think all of us come to the realization very often that our time is limited.
Yeah.
We run out of time to do certain things in a day. You know, whatever the case may be, our time is limited.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that I know I can do better in ordering my time to develop the better things.
Good.
There's a temptation, especially in a generation where we live, that there are things that have to be addressed. There are things that have to be taken care of or corrected or taken care of in that way. But spend time to develop the better things.
Amen. We should also remember that we shouldn't let the world define what's necessary.
Yeah.
I want to say something about that. Believe me too. Mm-hmm. Now, we use that a lot ourselves. Mm-hmm. We use that phrase, believe this or believe me. But now Jesus is not telling her so much as he's giving her something.
Uh-huh.
It's like that he's giving her to believe.
Yeah. That's
she
right.
Can.
She can.
She can believe.
You can.
And that's the way we need to. I need to do this myself. I've been subjected to a different way of thinking for so long. I've had to really just be But I've had to change my thinking when I read something like this in the scriptures. And instead of receiving them so much as a command, so I need to see it as an allowance
for
me. This is a move up. I can enter in here.
Amen.
These kind of things. But
remember when Paul said, "Sirs, be of good cheer, for I believe God." Yes.
One other comment on that salvation is of the Jews. How would you even know what salvation is apart from the Jews? The concept.
I think you
were expounding that it refers to Christ, which it does. But the idea of a God who saves people, where else does this come from?
That's right.
Other than the God of Israel. And that's not the only thing. How would you even know that God cares about you?
That's right.
The pagan gods don't care about their subjects. They're angry at their subjects. They curse their subjects unless their subjects bring them gifts and stuff. Mm-hmm. God gives to us. He cares about them. That is something that was revealed to the Jews.
To the Jews.
Amen.
That deliverance from Egypt is still held up.
Yes, amen. Amen.
As an example of deliverance.
Uh-huh.
Yes, Sister Melissa.
Yeah, I was thinking on this, believe me, too. There's a reward that comes with that. Mm. When you do it, the Lord does, He gives you something.
That's
so,
right.
So it's like He strengthens you every time that you believe Him. You're strengthened because every time you believe Him, you get whatever you're believing, you get some kind of... It's hard to explain unless you've done it,
unless
you've actually experienced it. But He increases your faith as you believe Him. Mm.
His words with power.
Yes, amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
Yeah, another thing about this created race that God did through Abraham and Sarah, it's a picture of what Christ was going to do in the new creation. And it's an impossibility. It's an impossible race. Mm. It couldn't happen. And yet God did it. And He isolated them and gave them their own language and everything so that they could be, to some degree, a holy people to where God could work through them.
That's right.
Otherwise, you'd have to have a flood every, few hundred years because it would decimate to that. But God, He took control of the situation and brought salvation.
Yeah. Amen. All right, we'll have Sister Barb take it.